My name is Jarrett Reddick, and this is a podcast. It's called Jarrett Goes to the Movies. Each week, we get together and talk about a movie that we watched that week, plus whatever the hell else is on our minds. And we're glad you're here.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to my underground lair. I have gathered here before me the world's deadliest assassins. And yet, each of you has failed to kill Austin Powers. That makes me angry. And when Dr. Evil gets angry, Mr. Bigglesworth gets upset. And when Mr. Bigglesworth gets upset, people die! Why must I be surrounded by frickin' idiots? Mustafa, Frau Farbissina, I spared your lives because I need you to help me rid the world of Britain's top secret agent, the only man who can stop me now. We must kill Austin Powers.
Oh man, welcome to Jarrett Goes to the Movies, weekly podcast right here where we like to watch movies and then talk about them.
Especially now because we don't have shit else to do.
Nothing else to do. Our format,
come on,
or at
baby.
Least our, the way that we
show me love.
Are able to do this is a little fucked up, but I listened to Howard Stern the other day.
And yeah!
Their show sounds like
Obi,
shit.
Hey.
So, you know, that's fucking Howard Stern. You know what I'm talking about? You follow me, Eric?
Yeah, that guy's way up there. So how should we be expected
to
do any better?
Yeah, well, no, we shouldn't. You know how many new supporters we got this week? Zero. So how can we improve?
That's 2 weeks in a row.
On the shittiness that we're putting out there, especially during this trying time.
So I people like already got enough problems.
Anything I'm doing, I'm saying, today's April 3rd, and we're doing this episode. So depending on if the news has completely changed, like let's say a whole country is wiped out before this comes
out.
That
could happen.
Then, and we don't mention it, then we're not being insensitive.
Right.
We just didn't know yet.
Or maybe
we did.
Maybe we do
this
know.
This just did.
And we're just that big of an asshole.
An entire country. That's been wiped out.
What's the country in this movie?
This one?
I don't know. We'll get there.
Yeah, we'll get there. With me, as always, is Eric. Eric, how you holding up, bud?
Man, this was the tough one. I don't know how everybody else is feeling, but, you know, I'm used to working from home, and so that part was pretty normal for a while. But, man, this week just, I think it all caught up between the kids being cooped up and nutso and weird and just, man, I was struggling. I texted you and Sean separately, just kind of like, man, this fucking sucks.
Yeah, I feel like I'm
crazy.
I feel like I'm starting to get that more and more. I was telling Amy before we started the show that the influx of messages that I've been getting for various reasons, all of them at some point or another talk about how much that person is drinking during all this. Like, and I, like for us, like for our family, for the family, well, Amy's here. So her family and the other families that were around, we won't throw under the bus. Mm-hmm. Copious amounts of alcohol
all the time,
just fucking just drinking it all.
Yep.
So that's why I think we're not going to get it, because alcohol, if you keep a hostile environment, you're good. Mm-hmm. You know,
thank you, Dr. Reddick.
Yeah, you're welcome. My lovely wife, Casey, is here. She doesn't have a theme song anymore.
Hello.
Is that so,
chopped in half.
That's
now
my new
just,
intro.
It's just crickets.
Casey.
Yeah. Well, you know, hi,
no
babe.
Intro.
Hi, babe.
Hi, babe.
K- Casey's been a rock star through all this homeschooling stuff, and you know, and has been really great at. Because here's the thing, I think that they're gonna have to step up bulk pickup too. We only get bulk pickup once month, and we're accumulating so much shit.
How does that happen?
They stopped doing it here.
Oh my God.
Put anything. So I've got a garage stacked up with. We haven't been in this house that long, and yeah, we got rid of most of the bulky stuff the first couple of months.
Yeah,
but we, there's
that's a
still
good point.
Stuff.
They can't go and just pick everything up with their hands. I guess that's the problem, huh?
I'm good, by the way. I'm doing great.
No, I was going to get back to our house. I wasn't done with my entry. I always come back.
You do this to me every week.
I always come back.
Go back and listen every week. My lovely wife, Casey, is here. She did this. Anyway, Eric, what do you think? Like,
well, that's not what happened. I was saying,
yeah, I just interrupted.
I was saying that you've been doing a great job at just keeping shit straight.
You know who else is doing a great job? Is this buddy of mine.
Which one? Oh, we can't hear him.
That is
Gary.
You can't hear Eric.
I can't. No, I was on the Facebook screen and not the other one, and it's lagging. So I thought
Well, that's what happens, man. That's what happens. Just 1 second. I've got to let me figure this out real quick. Okay, I got it. Hold on. I got to do this, and then I got to do this. Sean is here. Sean, hey buddy, how you doing?
Yo,
me and Sean
everybody.
we've already been working today, right? We did our we did the five questions.
Yep.
Went great. That was you. You're working a lot, right? I mean, everybody else, your workload is increasing, I would think, right?
Because of Mr. Michael. Yes.
Well, I'm just saying because of, you know, I mean, I'm busy. Well, I guess, you know, as far as I'm concerned, you don't really have as much Bowling for Soup. Like you just schedule all the posts and it's just done, I guess. Right. I mean,
yesterday, I was an MTV VJ on behalf of Bowling for Soup. I ran like 37 videos.
That's fun.
Yeah.
How was that for you?
It was, you know, as much fun as I could have.
Did you paint your pinky nail black to get like the full Carson Daly feel?
No. We had, so is that what happened with,
remember
so Chris
that?
Said,
about
we did a hangout two nights ago.
That I saw, and what you guys were talking about was in preparation for what I did yesterday.
Understood.
Because Swin wanted all of your music videos post Sony Jive uploaded.
Right.
And then he also wanted the live DVD, but we saw what happened with the live DVD stuff.
Okay.
I got flagged.
Right. Well, I'm sorry that happened.
Yeah.
There's literally nothing I can do about it. I'm glad you're here.
Hope your cave is okay.
Thanks. Yeah.
Amy Pitzinger is here. Hi,
hello.
Amy.
Hello, everyone.
Thank you for stepping in and being a part of this. It's great to have you here. And you said today, so we had, Casey and I had the board child today, mm-hmm. and you said it was like that at your house,
too. It was the exact same thing. They were in front of screens all day. I was okay with it.
Yeah.
Well, our Wi-Fi was out till like 4.
Yeah.
Like, No.
That sounds awful. Today, I could not have handled that.
You know, he did good. He really did. I, under the circumstances, I actually felt bad for him today. Like I was like, I feel like cats in the cradle with the silver spoon and shit right now. Like feel like I'm like, just go do this. Cause we had to watch this movie and we couldn't watch it in the living room. So we're, you know, he just kind of is in the rest of the house by himself. And I did feel bad. So I'm hoping that the weather isn't as shitty this weekend as it says it's going to be.
Yeah, I was hoping the same thing. Well, yesterday I thought it was going to rain all day.
Yeah.
And it didn't at all.
Yeah, we had these planter boxes. We've got these planter boxes that we're going to fill with dirt. And we thought it was going to rain all day yesterday. So we didn't do it. We probably should have.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, but that's okay.
Got the next day or the next day
or the next
or the
day,
one
know,
after that.
I mean, we have 3 to 4 months to do it. By the time we get it done, flowers won't even be growing anymore. You know,
we're going to be eating them.
Maybe. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah. Get those planter boxes going so we can plant some vegetables.
We did.
I'm trying to
self-sustaining over
They're
here.
They're so sad and they want out of the little things and I can't put them until I move the thingy.
Yeah.
We're going to move the thing. We're going to get it.
All the things need to be things.
That's right.
Before you can thing.
Right?
You know what? Small talk is not doing it for me. Let's get into the show. I want to just say that this particular program that you're listening to or watching right now, depending on what you're doing, is 100% supported by our Patreon supporters. Thank you guys so very much for sticking with us through this. And we got some cool exclusive content coming hopefully next week. Actually, we forgot to talk about that before, but hopefully some content that will be super fun, exclusive to you guys. One of the things that the supporters get to do is they get to vote on one of the movies each month. Our April movie poll was films that Eric should have seen by now. Now, there was a big, long list of these. And I am super surprised by the what won. But if everybody who could have voted would have voted, I don't think this one would have won. But up for voting was Unforgiven, Platoon, Raging Bull, Rocky, the original, and Jaws. And 1975 Jaws wins. So that's going to be interesting.
We already did Rocky.
Did we do Rocky 1?
Mm-hmm.
Which one did you think would have won?
I would have 100% thought that just anything but Jaws. Actually.
Really? Yeah.
Well, I mean, we're only 3 days in. I'm just showing you the current status.
Oh, so this isn't a win yet. You're just saying that it looks like it's going to. Oh, so you could send that thing today.
What was the bottom one?
Okay, Unforgiven.
I've never seen that or Raging Bull.
I haven't seen any but Jaws, and that's why I voted for Jaws.
I haven't seen Raging Bull. I haven't seen Unforgiven. I've seen Platoon.
What is Platoon?
Platoon's the feel-good movie of the year. No, it's Charlie Sheen.
Oh, then I've never seen that. I was thinking Stripes.
And it's not funny. In fact, none of these movies are funny. If one of them is going to be Stripes? Funny, Jaws is going to be the funniest one out of these. Okay, so then I want to encourage our Patreon supporters to go vote. I think Jaws is going to be a good podcast. So let me just back up and say that. Not just because I didn't think it was going to win doesn't mean that I don't think it's going to be a good show. Supporters are the lifeblood of this podcast. I want to thank David Dooley and Woody Chambers for being our producers. Our executive producers, that is. This is a David Dooley and Woody Chambers production. Our producers are Ad Craner, Amy Pitzinger. She's right over there. Andy Smith, Ashley C., Brian Mason, Brian Dunning, Shell Ordway, Chris the $6 Million Man Cranfill, Chris Holt, Chris Jacobs, Colton Swartz, Daniel Cotton, David Dooley, David Murray. Sorry, guys, when I hear a little pop like that, it makes me think my computer's about to go off. Where was I?
Derek Smith.
Derek Smith, Diane Small, Don Petretta, Gage Strickland, Gareth Roberts, Geraldine Darling, Gregory Cordone, Greg Lee, Greg Stevens, Jared Spear, Jeff Yeager, Jen Truitt Lewis, Jen Truitt Lewis, John Gickler, Josh Millman, Kim Murphy, Kirsty Fisher. Willie Hollihan, Lisa Winsel, Lucy Murray, Mandy Pretty, Michael Price, Mike Breton, Mike Hawk, Nick Brignoni. So here's the thing. That's a good one.
That
is a really good one.
It looks like legit.
Yeah. I totally thought you guys would have just put in the vagina one from the movie to see if I would do it. But that was really good. Mike Hawk. Nick Brignoni, Oliver Robbins, Rodon James, Rob Popplestone, Robert May, Sean Blackstone, Simone Vark, Steve May, Tess Green, Trey Wren, Vinny Cataldo, Wendy Croft, Woody Chambers, Zachary Van Ness, and Svi Hirse, everybody. Did I say Rodon James, or did I just go right through it?
You said it, and you said it like that.
I did? Yeah. Damn it, what is wrong with me? All right, well, thank you guys for being our... awesome. All right, before we get into this, we do have a movie review by Jared Spear. If you're at a certain level, you get to submit reviews anytime you want, and these are videos. So we'll post this up on the website since you guys can't actually see it. Here it is.
Hey guys, what's up? It's Jared Spear. Just wanted to do a quick review for Austin Powers International Man of Mystery, which I haven't watched in quite some time, but that's okay. So Austin Powers, basically Mike Myers being Mike Myers in England and chasing a crazy person, But does any of that really matter? Because Elizabeth Hurley, that's really the only thing I like about the movie. So there we go.
Yeah.
Have a good one, guys.
Good one. Yeah. If you're, we love hearing from you guys, by the way. So anything coming up, please, please chime in. Now, Austin Powers, International Man of Mystery, 1997, 7.0 on IMDb and 70% on Rotten Tomatoes. This movie cost $16.5 million and made $67 million at the box office. And I would think that after that is just freaking nuts, right?
I would think
so. You could have told me it made $350 million and I would have believed you.
Just
I don't, because that seems so low.
Yeah, it did, right? Okay, so now this is a fun news thing.
Over to Eric for his synopsis.
All right, here's how it works. Eric, had you seen this movie before?
Yeah, but just like American Pie, probably 97 was the last time I saw it.
All right, so first of all, we go to what Eric thought the movie was going to be about based upon his recollection of seeing it or the artwork on the front of the DVD. Here we go.
Austin Powers is a spy from the 1960s who is frozen and subsequently unfrozen in the 1990s in order to foil the world domination plans of his longtime adversary, Dr. Evil. Along the way, he learns about life, love, and how much things have changed since the swinging 60s with the help of his new sidekick.
Now,
Austin Powers, International Man of Mystery.
All right. Okay, that was a good one. That was pretty good. Now, Eric, go ahead. And you're a fucking asshole. Go ahead and read us the read us the synopsis.
I forgot I was supposed to do that. Let me pull it up.
Over to Eric for his synopsis.
A 1960s secret agent is brought out of cryofreeze to oppose his greatest enemy in the 1990s, where his social attitudes are glaringly out of place. So, I basically nailed it.
Yeah, I think so.
I mean, I feel like if you've seen it once, it's one of those movies where you don't have to watch it again to catch anything, because was all there. Do you?
Oh my gosh, yeah.
I guess I watched it 23 years in between, so I didn't know what to look for.
So you watched it the first time, you never watched it again.
I can't recall ever having seen it since then.
Man.
Let's talk about the cast. Mike Myers, who has pretty much made a career off of talking like a crazy Scottish person. My God, were his Saturday Night Live movies amazing. I mean, the Wayne's World was amazing, you know? And then...
Love Guru.
That one was really good.
Oh my God, I haven't seen that.
Oh, you would die.
Yeah?
Just laughing. Yes, it's so
funny. Okay. I gotta see that.
Justin Timberlake is in it.
Now, I can't remember who liked So I Married an Axe Murderer and who didn't.
Never saw it.
I liked it.
You liked it, Casey?
Yeah, I liked it.
Yeah, did we all like that? Sean?
Yep.
You liked it? Okay, good. All right, because I didn't remember if you guys shit all over that one or not.
Better than that piece of shit Beetlejuice.
You and the Beetlejuice.
What a weird thing to keep saying all the time.
Yeah, you're just wrong.
Yeah, also, like, fuck, man. You're going to hurt that dude's feelings.
Michael Keaton?
that dude. You're
4 years ago.
Oh, no, he not dead.
I was going to say, is he actually dead?
No, he is not dead. Michael York is in this. He plays... Why did you put him in here? I don't understand. Who does he?
Because you don't remember Michael York?
Hold on. Let me look and see who it is. Who is he? Why do I...
Because he...
Yes.
...was in Moscow Heat in 2004. He was on 4 episodes of Gilmore Girls.
The best 4.
Oh my God, that's amazing.
He was in...
Seth Green is in this movie as well. Seth Green, obviously, God, he's done a lot of shit now. Wait, who plays the vagina girl?
A lot of vagina?
A lot of vagina. Who plays that? She was a big star, right?
Was she?
Is that Selma?
Selma Hayek.
No. And no.
That's not Selma Hayek?
No.
It is not.
It's her sister, Thelma.
Hold on, I'm going to see. Thelma Hayek.
I fucking hate you.
Thelma Vagina.
A lot of it. Oh, no. Fabiana Udenio. Okay, maybe she's the girl from Summer School.
Udenio.
Yeah, I think she might be the girl from Summer
School. Oh, yeah.
Oh, that Fabi. I thought that was a boy's name. But yeah, it's Fabiana Udenio.
Right. Yeah. Is she the girl from Summer School? I'm trying to figure it out. She was on like Baywatch. I definitely know her from something. Oh, yeah, Summer School. And she was in Hard Bodies 2. Hmm. Boy, Hard Bodies 1 was a big one for those of us going through puberty in the 80s.
3 was a little flaccid for me.
It was. Hey-o!
Well.
Ding, 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 ding. All right, that's enough. Oh, well, and obviously Robert Wagner as well, who, great actor, probably got away with murder one time.
You know, Wagner.
That whole thing.
And Will Ferrell.
Look it up. Yeah, and Will Ferrell, who plays a guy who's dying.
Mufasa. Mustafa or something.
All right, guys, let's get into the movie. Here we go.
Hey.
Austin Danger Powers. One blue crushed velvet suit.
Hey, all right.
One frilly lace cravat.
There it is.
One silver medallion with male symbol. One pair of Italian boots.
Buongiorno, boys.
One vinyl record album. Burt Bacharach plays his hits.
Hey, bro. Yeah.
One Swedish-made penis enlarger pump.
That's not mine.
One credit card receipt for Swedish-made penis enlarger, signed by Austin Powers.
I'm telling you, baby, that's not mine.
One warranty card for Swedish-made penis enlarger pump, filled out by Austin Powers.
I don't even know what this is. This sort of thing ain't my bag, baby.
One book, Swedish-made penis enlarger pumps, and me. This sort of thing is my bag, baby, by Austin Powers.
Oh. I had forgotten about that scene fucking altogether. And just so funny because I watch a lot of prison shows, you know, as you guys know. I'm really big into prison. And
for obvious reasons.
Yeah, for obvious reasons, you know.
Yeah, you could not go to prison.
What?
No, you could not go to prison.
No, I just would have to be in solitary confinement.
But you're admitting you're not going specifically to famous person prison.
Oh, I'd have to go to famous person prison, right?
Where is that?
Disneyland.
Yes, I want
to
go.
A lot of people don't know that. All right, let's back up to the beginning of the motion picture where everything is just swinging, right? They're going to a swinging place and everybody's swinging. does anybody have any like old terms that you find yourself using anytime like... Like even this one, like rad has made a comeback.
I'll say rad.
That's fucking rad.
I always feel weird about saying it.
Really?
Any other ones out there?
Go
ahead, Sean.
Oh, I was going to say if something's like not cool or whatever, I'm like, you know, it's nothing to write home about, but I'm old, so.
Yeah, well, that's...
Is bummer, is that a comeback, or has that always been around? I've been wanting gaywad to come back for a long time. Yes! But it's just not working.
Dude, there's a guy on my Facebook from my hometown that says it all the time, and he'll just like, you gaywads need to do this.
Like, for real?
Oh,
does he mean it?
Yeah.
Oh my god, you're from another planet.
Oh, he like, and he puts into like political posts, like, you gaywads are voting the other way.
Oh my god.
Yeah. Yeah, just
I'd say bee's knees quite a bit.
That's a good one.
Oh, that is a good one.
Yeah.
Or the cat's meow.
Yeah. Isn't the cat's pajamas a thing? Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah. Hey, champ, you say Notre Dame is going to go out there like they're the bee's knees.
Lucy Murray with a punch to the gut with stoked, as you will see right here.
Stoked.
Nick Mignone actually said, now that's groovy. Now that's old school. That is. That is something else.
So you definitely
how
like
are you
people?
Getting that up on the screen?
I can do anything. Oh. I'm the goddamn
whoa.
Best.
Whoa.
Yeah. I'm really working hard back here to produce and fucking be on this show and fucking run it and drink beer, not piss my pants, try to laugh at your jokes. Like
I like Carrie Lynn Abner's "Oh Fiddlesticks." Mm-hmm. Oh Fiddlesticks.
All right, so I can't Google because I've got too many computer screen things here. It says music by George S. Clinton. So do you guys think that's like George Clinton from Parliament, or is it like one of those deals where I think that the guy?
It's an 80-year-old white guy, George Clinton.
Yeah, from Taxi, created Modern Family.
He is a white guy.
No kidding.
Yep, with a... He looks like that dude from...
He looks very black in all of the Parliament videos I've seen.
No, this guy... This guy's got, like, the hairline of the dude from Third Rock from the Sun that you so funny.
Roadhouse.
Which, oh, John...
John Lithgow.
John Lithgow, yeah.
He's a little Lithgow-y.
Oh, that guy is funny, but apparently he played... The villain in one of the seasons of Dexter.
He was so dude good.
Yeah, and apparently
the he Trinity, was Trinity yes killer.
Fucking terrifying, right?
He was. Scary. That was a good one.
I don't like it.
To set up the gag that comes later on in the movie, he's there in the fucking bar and he just goes, "I've got an idea," and then he just punches this woman in the fucking face. And she's just like, "Why did you punch that woman? This woman is a man, baby." Okay. And what's funny is that, like, I didn't remember that at all. And I definitely didn't remember it setting up the gag that happens later yep with the dude's mom, but it made it so fucking funny.
Well, and then when, like, they shoot back to this man yeah on the ground, like, it doesn't look, they didn't even put a wig on this yeah man. Yeah,
just a yeah man.
Nope.
He's got a 5 o'clock shadow and everything.
That's part of what it is, though. But, you know, and then obviously we, you know, you can see the love between him and Mrs. Kensington. And I like the scene later. We'll talk about it where he talks about her. And it's kind of a sweet moment, you know,
but not even creepy. Like you would expect it to be creepy for yeah him, but it wasn't.
He breaks down for a second yeah just like, you know what? He was essentially basically saying your dad loved her and I loved her, but you got there first.
Yes.
And then, so as he's escaping, which is just the stupidest thing ever, Dr. Evil has set up it somehow just at this random nightclub that he will go into a freeze chamber and launch Big Boy into the sky. And as the door closes, they just look at each other and just fucking start shooting it. And me and Casey both just died laughing at that because it was like, you know, why do you know what is happening right now? And then Big Boy just gets
bullets won't bounce around or anything.
Big like boy,
like that.
A total steel-lined room.
Right,
those bullets will just go all over the place.
Did you guys notice when they walk into the chamber to unfreeze him? Who else was in the other boxes?
Yes, Gary Coleman. Yes. Yeah, Vanilla Ice.
Yeah. And then there's one that it looks like he's, I couldn't tell if it was a different one from Vanilla Ice or if it was supposed to be the Dolph Lundgren guy from Rocky 4 or whatever, like the big Russian dude. I couldn't tell, but
I will break anyway you.
I will break you. Yeah. But how good for Vanilla Ice though, man, to be like spoofed in like one of the biggest
featured. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Good job.
In 97, which is only about 5 years after he was popular, right?
Good job, Rob Van Winkle.
From Richardson Berkner or wherever.
Yeah, it's weird. He lived in Paris, Texas for a while, I guess, too, because Casey's mom went to school with him.
She kissed him on the mouth in a closet.
Ooh.
Casey's mom.
Oh, man.
My favorite gag before they unfreeze him is when he goes, wait, Big Boy is back?
Oh, and
he goes,
no.
Well, you know, in a lot of ways, Big Boy never left. They've always been yeah providing affordable
oh my God
burgers.
That was so fucking funny. They've been meals at a very affordable price. He just goes.
It reminds me of that, like, airplane gag when they would, you know, I guess they picked the wrong day to quit sniffing glue.
Yeah.
Just like that deadpan delivery, you know.
Right. He just does the forget what you saw and hangs up on him and then tells the guy, to, oh, and. Hey, get me an overnight bag. Oh, and also feed my fish.
Right.
Not too much.
What's funny?
Yeah, because he feeds them, he scoops a little out.
Because look, there are some of these gags that go on far too long and are fucking stupid.
Yeah, but it's like the Family Guy thing, like with the knee thing. Like uh-huh. It's like the longer it goes, it's funny. Then it's stupid. Then it's funny again.
So two of the best bits ever that like. Me and Casey were just talking about this the other day, and I didn't remember that it came from this. For some reason, I thought it was like the Scottish guy in in one of his other movies or whatever, but when he first wakes up, he was just like, yes, and that's because I have no control over the volume of my voice. And like, oh my God, that's fucking funny. So and then,
which is a me thing.
And then
she says that to me all the time because I do that. I like when I am in uncomfortable situations, I have no control over how loud my voice gets.
Yeah. Well, this is a really awkward situation.
I'm like, what the fuck? Like,
Emma did that the other day in Olive Garden. Remember that? Started talking about like,
I yelled, sorry, your dog died as loud as I could at a girl's face, like with no other, like, and like literally like she just cried.
Oh,
and our other friend just looked at us and just goes, was that? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't know why.
The other one that he does is where he says the thing is, boy, I would really like to shag her. She's, you know, and it just, oh my God, I have no inner monologue anymore. Did I just say that out loud? Okay.
I forgot about a part when he's going through the little process and at the very end, the evacuation.
Fuck! Oh, yes, right. I had that down.
I lost my mind. I forgot all about it.
Yeah.
I used to watch this movie over and over again, and every single time I lose it.
Just the leaning on the wall and then kind of stepping back up or whatever, and then just his little feet, you know, like, and they start to
evacuation come.
Just the scene transitions, like, you know, when they do the deal where and he's in the, you know, and it's just all dances. The people around it. Just so like,
I wish my entire life, like every time I was doing something different in the day, there was like a small dance number.
Just a thing, right?
With like, full choreographed, like costumed.
Yeah.
People. We can make that happen for your birthday.
100%.
For like a whole, like
a whole day. We just
100%
do choreographed dance behind you.
Well, it's not like we're going to have a lot of ground to cover. We're probably going to be in the same three houses that we're in right now.
On my birthday?
Practice at my house starts Tuesday.
Yeah. Okay. Rehearsing.
I want one of those parades everybody's getting. All the little kids.
Oh, yeah. Those are cute.
We'll figure that out. The complications during unfreezing for Dr. Evil are that he got a fucking hairless Mr. Bigglesworth. And Casey goes, are you sure we can't get one of those? And I go, yeah, we fucking can't. I'm gonna get one eventually.
Those things freak me out.
Oh, they're just so ugly.
Have you seen them when they're babies? They're just like little ball sacks. They're
But that's what it feels like it would be like when you pet it, right? Like you're
petting.
No,
you don't touch it. Mm-mm.
But it does. It feels like it would have like peach fuzz skin.
Like a baby.
No, the balls are really the only thing I can think of right now.
Like a little
baby
ball sack.
God damn it.
What?
Nothing. If Sean didn't notice, then we're good.
Dude, did you know that on the Facebook version of this, it closed captions everything we say?
Yeah, I noticed that just now. I thought maybe, I didn't know what was happening.
What are you talking about?
I mean, I
there's
feel like I like
there's
explained
a closed
it
caption at the bottom. Pretty look.
Well.
Hello, Eric is an asshole.
Yeah, we just said ball sack a couple times. He
does it
write
say
that
it?
Down. I don't know. We got to wait a second.
I wonder if I could turn that. Should I leave that on? That's kind of neat, though, because deaf people can watch.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Go on.
No, I mean, that's it. It's fucking love subtitles. Plus, sometimes, you know, like...
You know, I thought they only read sign language.
Deaf people?
I can't do this anymore.
Or are you doing blind
go.
People?
I gotta go.
Yeah. She's imploding, remember?
Yeah, Jesus Christ.
I gotta leave.
The fucking... was it earlier?
They can read.
Wait a minute. Today, is it during... Hey, is it during Five Questions where you do the Helen Keller joke or whatever? Is that later?
Anne Frank.
No, I think you said Helen Keller. Why would it be Anne Frank? That doesn't make any sense.
Why would Anne Frank have a drum set?
Oh, because she's supposed to be quiet. Is that right? Because they were in the they were living in the attic.
Because what would she need a drum set for?
I don't know. She's living up there in the attic with
you said Anne Frank, and I still thought you were talking about Helen Keller.
No, Anne Frank's up in the attic, and there's this boy up there. His name's Thomas or some shit. And they 100.
You're thinking children in the attic. Children, flowers in the attic.
In the attic.
No. There's a little boy so that lost. Moves into the attic, and she
incestuous.
Has a little crush, and he 100% fingered her, and she had to be super quiet.
Yeah, well,
it did happen.
They don't tell you that at the Auschwitz Holocaust Museum, but.
All right. So, and then
they do if you pay extra.
Of course, Will Ferrell's big moment in this is being Will Ferrell. And he fucking gets dumped off there. And that shit really is funny. Just with the guys, I'm not dead yet. I am in a lot of pain.
Very badly burned.
Whatever. Ah, you shot me in the arm.
Dr. Evil gets on the phone and he's like, yeah, bad. He's badly burned. Yeah. Where were we?
Why did you do that?
Yeah, that character like carries on too, because he's in like other movies. Like he's in like the next one, I think. Yeah.
Why does he survive this or something? He like
comes... That's the thing. He like won't ever die.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Remember the whole thing? He's like, it smells like almonds or whatever. Yeah, like that's where that came from.
That makes sense.
I forgot about that. Good point.
Sorry, guys. And then
bitch.
As he's introducing them all or whatever, and then there's the one guy who's the guy who's like, they're always after me Lucky Charms. Why does everyone laugh when I say that? You know, just I don't
fucking cereal.
She goes, I thought Frau's explanation was funnier than the whole
thing.
It was
so good. She's just like, because the children
are the Lucky Charms and Lucky Charms.
And then they eat it, and it's like, oh, you get them. It's like I'm eating the candy. You know, whatever. Like,
just put it right there in the cereal.
And then he goes, I want to introduce you to my number two man. This is number two. And I don't know why I think that is so funny, but man, that's
because it comes back
funny.
Later.
Yeah,
it does in the best way. It's my favorite part of the film. Man, we will
I
get there.
About this part, but yeah.
We'll yeah. Well,
and,
no, go
and
ahead.
Then another know. Top five is the same guy at the end. Where he goes, I'm not going to let you talk to me like that anymore.
Robert Wagner. Yeah. I mean, what's crazy is he is a, I mean, that dude's like a historically, I mean, he's fucking famous as fuck, you know, not as famous as me, but he's up there. Now, how about the
man? I don't know.
What do you mean?
Is there a website we can go to? Like who's more famous?
I don't believe so. No, I don't believe there is. I don't even believe that that's even searchable.
Maybe there's going to be an app for that.
I mean,
the Kevin Bacon thing, like determine.
Yeah.
Wait, I'm fucking right there, right? We already got me. I'm 1 degree. I'm good. Hey, but let's talk about this. When he hands the cat to like the wrestler guy that throws the shoes, and the guy, he takes him on accident with his arm and he just sits there. It starts to be seem like it. What I realized from this for the first time was it's very Mel Brooks. And for those of you youngsters, which is everybody but me, Mel Brooks is like Spaceballs and Blazing Saddles. There's just a lot of that kind of humor in this movie. And that bit really struck me as that. And again, also just the whole deal where he starts to say about what he's going to do to the place. He goes, okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to tell everybody that Prince Charles had an affair. And
so random.
And, sorry, Eric. I missed that. I didn't see you do that. Let's see.
Eric's opening a beer.
Every time.
Production value so good.
Just the, but the $1 million just gets into more Borat, right? I mean, yeah. So good. Sean, do you keep muting yourself? I got you unmuted.
No, I'm here.
For a while.
All right, buddy.
I'm here in my cave.
Sorry, I only have four spots up here, and everybody's talking.
I just make sure you don't have any issues. That's the only reason I'm here.
All right. Well, I love you, boo.
Boo.
And then when he's filling out they're like, sex? Yes, please. I fucking used to do that joke all the time when I was a kid. And, yeah, I didn't really ever have any luck with it.
I was going to say, did it work?
No, not once. Not even once. And then just the whole, like, when are we going to go back and shag is so much. It's so 60s-y. And he just keeps doing it to her or whatever. And she fucking finally falls for it. You know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
On the airplane, you just know it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Because he goes,
where are you going to sit over there? What do you think is going to happen?
He goes, she's actually going to go sit there? Yeah. Like,
he goes, can I show you something? He gets in there, do I make you horny? And she just fucking goes over there and sits down. Like, why are you doing that? You don't need to go. It's
wrong
a
move.
You're on a huge airplane.
Right. There's a lot of space.
There's probably seven more rooms in that thing. It's a jumbo jet, for Christ's sake.
Oh, I fell over.
Now, so you had seen this before, Eric, right? Just basically when it came in. How did you feel like it aged? Seriously.
Man, when you said that this had a 7.0 on Rotten Tomatoes or on IMDb and a 70 on Rotten Tomatoes, that's exactly perfectly perfect for this to me.
Yeah.
It was just a C movie.
Hmm.
And I thought it aged fine because there's not a pop, it's, there's not a lot of 1990s pop culture references per se, except for when he's trying to fit in, you know, so it was fine.
Man, I'm going to say that I was very surprised at how well I thought it aged and how funny I thought it was. I did not expect to laugh as much as I did. And seriously, like, full on belly laugh a couple of times. I remember it being funny back in the day. And I remember when Goldfinger came out, Goldmember mm-hmm. came out. We were in England and we went to go see that one. And I'll never forget, it's the first time that we had ever seen reserved seats in a theater and you could drink beer in there. And, you know, they were onto something, but it wasn't like reserved seats where you could recline. It was like reserve seats at a PTA meeting, you know, that kind of thing. Well, I just mean those kind of seats, like at a, I guess not a PTA meeting, but like in a, it's like a high school auditorium, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
But like not padded.
Yeah.
Like they were wooden and they folded up and you're all super close together.
Like at a baseball stadium or something.
Yeah, but yes, but more, but inside.
More English.
But like at a more hockey English. Match.
Like, okay, yeah. I think my description was really good. High school.
Like if you're sitting in seats and like you're able to set some aside for people who have previously decided that they want to sit there, but the seats aren't like modern movie theater seats like that we all know, where, you know, they're very cushioned and they lean back, almost one might even say recline, and they have like cup holders and stuff. Like, we're not talking about those kind of seats, I don't think.
I think you're on thin ice here, pal.
Sucky. So
am I right or
no? I was just thinking back to when I had my first beer. And
like in court?
I didn't have a beer in court. Court is a good one, only it's slanted, like you're at a fucking thing. It's wooden chairs in an auditorium. You know what? Maybe
like at the Grand Ole Opry or something.
Yes, that's it.
There we are.
Like, exactly like the fucking Grand Ole Opry. And that's where we watched Austin Powers 2 Electric Boogaloo. Okay.
Electric Boogaloo.
So
at the Grand Ole Opry?
A dick fucking
Amy.
No.
Oh,
Eric.
No.
No, no. Hold on. No, I'm not. No, I'm, that's not what I was.
No.
Uh oh.
No. Okay. Sorry. God damn it.
In his defense, those were big wieners.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you suck it.
Yeah, so you suck it. All right, let's meet.
What's the point of sucking cock if they're not huge?
Slapped in your face.
Oh, man. You're going to have a heyday with this.
God bless it.
Dr. Evil, I want you to meet your son.
My son?
Yeah. Scott!
Was that?
Hello, Scott.
Hi.
I'm your father, Dr. Evil.
I haven't seen you my whole life, and now you come back and just expect a relationship? I hate you.
What? Could I have a hug?
No.
Give me a hug.
No way.
Come here.
I'm not coming over there.
Let's go.
Forget it.
Toronto.
Oh, man.
That was genius.
I like sensitive Dr. Evil. So we have a bit of an echo.
I was hearing the same
thing. I'm going to try to see if I can figure out what it is. Hold on one second. Hello, hello, hello. Hey, Eric, that's coming from you.
Somehow. Oh, shit.
Hold on. Hello, hello. Oh, no, it's gone now.
It's gone. Sean... Did I catch that in that clip?
Yeah, he put that. Was that the bitch song in there, Sean?
Yeah.
Nice job, buddy.
That was good.
Nice job. All you have to do basically to get rid of things that are wrong is just blame Eric and they all go away. I wonder why that is. That's fucking weird.
Yeah, I was just sitting here.
Yeah,
which is,
well,
it's coronavirus, weird, you know? Your fault.
It's weird that the only thing that's wrong, you blame you, and all of a sudden you're like, "Wait, that's not me," and that's fucking what's fucking goddamn wrong. You know, you never know.
Cool. Thanks, Woody. Cool,
yeah.
Cool.
Well,
look what you did, you little jerk.
Yeah.
Wait, I didn't mean to play that. Okay. So I think my favorite Dr. Evil thing of all time is the "I'm hip." And he starts doing the Macarena or whatever the fuck he's doing. It's so funny. So I do that to my kids all the time.
I still do that.
Oh, yeah. Hold on. Sorry.
That is something Jared says.
Just the I'm hip. Fucking love that shit.
And anyone that was named Scott in the late 90s.
Oh, Scott!
Yep. That was it.
Yeah, so Howard Stern uses that a bunch because his engineer's name's Scott, and anytime they talked to him, and I had forgotten that this is where that came from until he walked out, and I was just like, oh, shit. But I forgot that she does it all the time. Guards! Like, it's just...
Oh, yeah.
That fucking voice is just so good. It's so good.
And she doesn't have an accent or anything. It's just...
So the blackjack scene happens, and it's the goddamn soup Nazi, and that made me laugh. It's the no soup for you guys. Are you guys Seinfeld people?
No.
Hilarious.
All right, so blackjack table, here we go. He introduces himself as Richie Cunningham and my wife, Oprah. And then, of course, the name that I thought I would see on today's introducing the producers, A Lot of Vagina, which is so great. But and then obviously staying on five is an amazing gambler's joke. It's so great.
I'll stay.
Yeah, it's just, oh, yeah, I'm a man of danger, too. It's just that really.
Also. And then he just immediately has 20. Oh, okay. Shit, sorry.
Oh, but so this Tom Arnold scene is, I mean, it has to be like the one from the movie.
It's my favorite.
You know what's funny, though, is that I forgot about
it. Yeah, this one's not a memorable one.
I know it's really? Like, who does number two work for?
Yeah.
But I forgot about Tom Arnold in the next stall. Like, well, yeah.
Like, give him hell.
Yeah, grab down
the bachelor. Blow out of nowhere.
He did.
He goes, we're going to get through this.
Yeah. You can do this, man. And then, and also something that I, hold on. Oh.
That is something Jared says.
What, you don't like this one either?
Is that a new one?
Yeah.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a new one. All right. Well, guys, I got to get rid of the debt.
That's because it will be the
voice.
Whole podcast. All you do is quote movies.
Yeah. Sorry about that, guys.
Just keep it on a loop in the background.
Those listeners that hate it, I'm really sorry. But the courtesy flush.
Oh, it's so good.
That's where it comes from.
And this is the third movie in a row, or three out of the last four, that has had a explosive, weird bathroom.
That's what I said.
Is that what happened
weird
here?
Yeah, we had Harold and Kumar,
right?
And then American Pie, and now this.
All right, that echo.
Cool, Eric. Thanks,
hold on, Eric. Eric, actually, let's try to solve this problem real quick. Actually, will you do me a favor and just will you just log out and log back in and see if we can get rid of that echo, because it shouldn't be doing it. Peace out. Glad we got rid of that guy.
Yeah. Good move.
Hey, Sean. How you doing?
Good.
Hey, if the echo was still there, we wouldn't fucking tell him, by the way.
No.
Guys, we got 19 people in the chat. How you guys doing in the chat? All right.
All right.
I do have to pee.
And I'm going to use this as an opportunity to...
All right, let's see. Eric.
What?
I think that did it. You did it, great. Dude.
Great.
Can you hear Amy?
Hello.
Did you hear Amy say hello?
Hello again. He's just
gonna say Eric, stop it.
No. Yeah,
I hear it. See right through it.
You son of a biscuit. I came back in too hot. Why is it so hot?
Oh, Sean was hot too.
Ooh, Sean.
Woo!
Coming in sleeveless, drinking a beer.
My goodness, do we even know you?
I spilt it on my shirt.
Fucking quarantine, no rules.
Oh, that's funny.
Oh, man. Were we even to the fucking point of, we didn't even finish that last clip.
Oh, the bathroom scene. That's what we were talking about, because I forgot about the part where he walks in and he goes, you didn't happen to see anything,
did you? Right. So I thought the whole time, I was like, okay, that guy's going to be an agent or whatever.
Right.
And then, but then the one thing that you don't know, if you noticed, Tom Arnold walks in and he does the thing where he like throws the door in and you just hear this.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry about that.
Get up.
Yeah.
Well, when he walks in and he goes, did you happen to see nothing at all?
Nothing at all.
Nothing at all.
What do you say about, he goes, no, I'm English. And he goes, sorry.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry about that. Cause he goes, nice get up there. But we talked about that shit together, but you know, what did you eat? You know? So,
oh, yeah. Jesus Christ, boy.
So after that, you know, Dr. Evil brings in everybody or whatever for the thing where he's going to decide what he's going to do or whatever. And they do the evil laugh. And that's one of those Family Guy bits that just goes on and on on. And me and Casey laughed at that thing because it just ends up being him and the lady by the end of it. Like nobody else. I think they probably did that on purpose. Like they just kept going. Like, how long can we possibly stay in character this? You know? It's like you when you do your evil laugh, David Dooley. Remember?
John posted that video of when we had the goat singing video David Dooley was here, and it sounds like you pressed play on the board, but it's really just him in the studio laughing exactly like that, which is so great.
That laugh is so good. I mean,
I wish I could be that happy about anything in my life.
You're right. It's so good. So good. Let me think about this for a second. Call a mom. Oh, they do the scene where so Elizabeth Hurley calls Mimi Rogers on the phone and
Eric's opening a bill.
And calls her on the phone, and it's the first one of those deals with the angles or whatever, because he just gets up and everywhere, you know, it covers his naked body or whatever. And what a funny fucking idea.
It's
so funny. And like it just, the more insane it gets, and they take it to the next level the next time they do the bit. So good. And then so Casey's favorite part of this movie, or at least something that Casey does.
Is something that Casey does.
Is the stairs, escalator, canoe, elevator.
I don't do that. I just think it's funny.
No, but didn't your brother used to do it all the time or something?
No, do it.
No, I just thought it was hilarious. I mean, this movie came out whenever I was like 6 to 7. So the first time I actually saw it, I was probably 9 or 10.
Yeah.
And that was the funniest thing I'd ever seen.
So funny.
It is really funny. Yeah. And then,
because everyone's seen the stairs, but like the canoe was so good.
Yeah, the canoe is fucking good. What about Me in a Nutshell? Did you think that was funny?
No.
This is me like,
how did I get into this nutshell?
I did. I thought it was fucking hilarious. That was you. Now, we talked about this earlier. It was the sweet scene where he like actually breaks down his relationship and basically says, you know, hey, if you know, she really loved your dad, and if there was any one person that could have loved her besides your dad, it would have been me. And it was really, really sweet. And so then he banged her daughter.
Yeah, I thought about that too. That just seemed weird. It's like, then I would have been your dad, but I'm not. So let's do this.
It was so sweet. It was just like, you know, because your dad's a great guy, but essentially he got there first. And so.
And not to mention, like, I mean, for 30 years, her mom still looked pretty good. Like, he probably could have still made it work.
Yeah.
If they were that in love.
Well, we don't know what happened to the dad. I mean, he might still be alive.
I always just kill people off for like my own benefit. Like, I have like specific, like if I die, wives for Jarrett. And he's like, that's what about Dave? And I'm like, well, Dave's got to go. Like, she's on the pre-approved list. So if you're gone, he's got to go.
Well, one time you did the list in front of Dave, and Dave goes, what about me?
Yeah. Sorry, Dave.
That did happen.
That's funny.
Now, oh, and you're on the list, by the way. You're approved.
Oh, okay. So what about Derek?
Yeah. So he's gonna,
I feel like the longer time goes, I feel like maybe not. I feel like it's all becoming like a family-oriented thing. Yeah, you know
little,
what I mean?
Yeah, it gets a little weird.
Well, but so she's I've off also, the list. That's fine.
I've also told Derek, though, that if I go, if I kick the bucket...
Switch the churches. Sorry. That's a chicken joke from the 80s.
Go ahead. The bucket and the chicken
yeah,
in the bucket.
Yeah.
So if I kick the chicken in the bucket, I told Derek that he has to consult everyone in the group
yeah. for the
if
new
find someone to date.
Right.
I'm yeah. like, you I need everyone's signatures. I should actually draft right. a consent form.
Right.
Or something. I need to have that lined up.
Yeah.
Go ahead and print out two of those.
Right. I will. Because you know that I will. I've got all this thought out.
Yeah. He has a couple pre-approved people.
Now
mainly just yeah, two.
Two.
Am I one of them?
Two people.
It's his friend Lisa and then Kelly from the Dolly Rots.
Right, which two husbands have to die.
Or just, you know, be cool with you marrying in or...
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, maybe you just join in.
Lisa was aware that she was on the list. I don't believe Kelly knew, but she does now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but Kelly would just assume. Am I right?
Probably, yeah.
I'm just saying, like, people I think you would have, like, a fun time for the rest of your life with and would be nice to my child.
Yeah. Well, those are good ones.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is a good one.
They are good ones. So you guys know what I've got going on after Casey's dead. I'll tell you that much. Now, when he gets the him with the laptop is fucking hilarious because he opens up it's like ringing and he opens it up like he doesn't really know what to do. And it does the ding, you've got mail. And that this is really the only part where the movie ages itself.
Because that was high tech.
But I actually thought it was really funny that it wasn't so high tech. You know, like it almost made it funnier to me. Like, had he opened up like a Mac or whatever, it wouldn't have been as funny. It's right. like that real clunky, just fucking stupid laptop.
Yeah, but that was like the shit.
Yeah.
Because for a while it was like the smaller
that
the
was
laptop.
Sleek.
Yeah.
In 97.
Now, get to a lot of vagina's penthouse immediately. Eddie does. He gets there. And of course, she knows the right moves to make. Now, the funny thing about this whole thing is that it doesn't really matter. Like just the fact that whole thing happened, it doesn't, there's no impact to the story at all. Did you guys think about
that?
Yeah,
but that was the whole thing about Bond movies, is that there was always a really hot female antagonist or protagonist.
Right. No, but what I'm saying, okay. But
so I think they were just playing off that.
All of it's a spoof off of that. So,
but stick with me though, like, but usually they were like a bad person, right? Or they were just with the bad. Okay, I see what you're saying. It didn't need to do that.
And I think she was useful to show that Elizabeth Hurley actually did care for
sure.
him.
Sure. You had to develop that relationship somehow, because
right.
we went from them wrestling on the plane to her going, I think I want to be with you. And he's like, I think I want to be with you too. And you're like, my God, when did this relationship happen?
Yeah.
So she gets him and that's the other thing is she gives him the sake and you think, okay, she's going to poison him. So yeah. Is that part of the spoof too? Is like they would just seduce James Bond?
No, he would always seduce them. Like, it was always about him working his mojo, baby.
Right.
Mojo.
Right.
And, so they had to include that.
Right. So they, anyway, she really got him relaxed. And just
yeah, what was in
so
that?
Relaxed.
And so there's two amazing dad jokes here. The first one is I'm gonna go to the second one first because I think you guys will remember the first one. But it's when he farts and she goes, "How dare you break wind before me?"
Right?
And he goes, "Oh, sorry, I didn't realize you wanted a turn or whatever.
Sorry, I didn't know it was your turn.
I didn't know it was your turn." What's the dad joke that happens before that?
He has like a poem.
There's a fart poem that I completely forgot about that I used to say all the time.
Okay, and what is it?
Pardon me for being rude. It was not me. It was my food. It just popped up to say hello and now it's going back down below.
Did he say that?
Yes. And I used to say it all the time.
Okay, so there's even a joke before that really dad jokey too, where she's like massaging him or whatever. Ah, oh, fuck, I can't think of it. But anyway, I missed that. I don't know how I missed that fucking poem.
Oh,
yeah, you were there.
Did you know
favorite poem that's ever been written.
What about beans are my favorite fruit?
Yeah.
No.
You guys, yeah, fart poems? Like, that's another one of those things where we were talking about the other day about things that used to spread without the internet, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Beans. Now, what did y'all used to say? Beans, what's the
magical fruit?
Magical fruit.
The more you eat, the more you toot.
The more you toot, the better you feel, so eat your beans at every meal.
Yes.
Right.
Or there was beans, they're good for the heart.
More you eat, the more you fart.
But the rest of it was the same.
Right. That's the one that I remember. Beans, good. Now, we also had one that went, and I don't run into a lot of people that knew this one. Okay. Here we go. All right. Going down the highway, doing 94. Someone let a big one and they blew me out the door. The wheels couldn't take it. Engine fell apart. All because Eric let a supersonic fart. And we actually were saying,
know what I had to do with any of that.
Yeah. Well, we were saying that back in the day, like even, and I always wondered who Eric was, and I'm so glad I got to meet you.
Eric Chandler, your former bass player.
No, it wasn't him. He didn't fart.
No. Yeah.
Eric didn't. Eric thought farts are gross. You're a farter. That's you.
He wasn't very farty, was he?
Eric was never a farter. In fact, I never heard him.
Me neither am I. What are you talking about?
Yeah, you're the fucking fart mayor.
No, you.
We're sick of it, Eric.
Yeah, mayor. It's just fucking weird.
Although Jared did fucking clear the room here at the end of the last one.
Man. That was embarrassing. That was embarrassing. It was. That was really bad. That one was really bad.
Yeah, it's like in the walls.
It's like
it's ingrained.
I brag about not being a smoker and I got to take it back now. They're going to have to fucking re-sheet rock it anyway. You know?
It's in the vents.
It's everywhere. They're going to change the ductwork. All that shit, you know? Now, no, Eric wasn't big into farting early on, but he embraced it later. His farts were the stinkiest in the band, and everybody will 100% vote on that. And always silent, and he would always not say anything. And then was just really, really, really bad. Like, the rest of us will fucking just be like, okay, you know, whatever. And there it is.
Yeah, y'all are so cool.
Yeah, we fucking are. We're all famous. So,
this is a rough one.
I mean, maybe hang something on
the wall. No, not rough. It's just,
I'm just sitting back watching the,
why?
Maybe hang something.
I've never farted in your studio ever.
Is that really true?
Yes.
You've never farted in here?
Why would I? I respect you too much.
Well, then you should feel comfortable here and fart when you're supposed to.
I do feel comfortable.
When you're supposed to.
No, when your
body tells you it's time.
Yeah, when your body says it's time, if you really fucking respect me, let that shit go. Yo.
I'm not withholding it from you.
Oh.
It's your butt secret.
Dude, I'm not withholding it from you is really a fucking funny thing to say.
Yeah, I say funny shit all the time. You don't know.
Oh no, I never, that's the first one I've heard.
Yeah. First time for everything.
There is. All right, let's go to the next clip. Well, no, let's first say about the fembots or whatever. And he goes, after she shoots he goes, I like girls of that caliber, whatever. Just like,
and then he's got to explain
the joke.
That's a good bit.
Yeah.
My kids especially like it when I make jokes that they already got, and then I go on. That, especially with Zoe.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's the if you over explain the joke, they didn't laugh the first time, then they will start to laugh after it. Yeah.
Bow show.
It's time for 5 questions with 6 questions and a high score of 7.
Guys, welcome to America's favorite podcast game show, because it's the only podcast game show brought to you right here each and every week on Jared Goes to the Movies. And this week we have got a doozy for you. Chris Cranfill, Jared Spear, and of course, one of our bosses, David Dooley. It's too bad we can't cheat for the bosses anymore. Those were the good old days. But ladies and gentlemen, it is going to be a blast. First of all, give it up for, of course, one of the boss men himself, Mr. David Dooley, everybody. Let's give it up for him. David Dooley with 3 wins and 7 attempts. 2 away from a plaque, guys. Of course, give it up also for Chris Cranfill, former boss.
of the show. One win for it is. And Jared Spear, an OG supporter, ladies and gentlemen, been with us almost since the beginning.
We love you long time.
And I should say that David Dooley been there for the, and Chris Cranfill got here as fast as he could. That's right. We and then just allowed us to overtake his house with a poker party and they were fucking fighting in the street and shit. Fucking crazy. All right, guys. Question number one will of course be about the movie Austin Powers. In the movie Austin Powers, you have two super hot Kensingtons. Name both actresses. Two super hot. We have a Mrs. and a Miss Kensington. Name both actresses.
I have to get a pen. Sorry, guys. Okay.
Name both actresses. Both of them have really big hands.
That reminds me of a Jirena song.
That used to be a joke back in the day. Be like, oh, she's got really, you guys can see me, but the audience, guy, she's got really big hands, you know. Yep. All right, guys, let's go to David Dooley first, who got a head start writing. What did you say?
Elizabeth Hurley and Mimi, I think it's Rogers.
All right, and Chris Cranfield, what did you say?
I don't know if you can see it. Elizabeth Hurley, maybe Roger.
Guys, I've got to throw this question out because I was supposed to let Jared Spear answer first. Actually,
it's okay. I'm not gonna cheat. I didn't know Mimi Rogers.
Okay, so, and he's honest.
Obviously, I knew Elizabeth Hurley.
Hey, Jared. Two things you need to know about her: she was married to Tom Cruise. But the most important thing that you need to know is about her is she likes to show those things. And later on, when you're Googling, she has this scene where she just stands in front of this guy who is sculpting her for like 30 minutes. And they're just all out there with the stuff and the things. All right, guys. Chris Cranfill and David Dooley both with one. Jared on the honor system, taking one for the team because I fucked up. Now still has zero. And this next question will, of course, be about the movie Austin Powers. Ladies and gentlemen of the podcast, this podcast used to have a cast member whose real name was Austin. What was his nickname? Used to have.
Can you say that again?
This podcast used to have a staff member named Austin. What was his nickname?
Man, I bet he's going crazy right now. He's so like he's always out Instagramming what he's doing and shit.
Not right now, he's not because he can't hear this. Sean will edit this question out.
Yeah, we can say whatever we want about him.
Okay, Jared Spears, what you got?
Sweet Cheeks.
All right, and David Dooley.
Sweet Cheeks.
Chris Cranfill at a bit of a disadvantage coming on. Question mark? Yes, coming on a little later as a supporter. I will say, though, that he was here. He was here when you began supporting the podcast. So
I do remember
about 6 months.
I do remember him, yeah.
Okay, guys. Question number three, David Dooley with two. Cranfill and Jared both with one. This will be question number three about the movie Austin Powers. In the movie Austin Powers, what? Hold on. I got it. What song plays when he goes up against the Fembots? What song plays when he lights five cigarettes and throws them into the Fembot's mouth?
That scene is still hilarious.
Dang it.
This is a tough one. I got accused of just throwing softballs a while back. So
damn
now,
it,
I'm
Sean.
Now I'm just throwing my ball sack. Oh, no, you have no idea. Last week, Sean, for the fucking super hard question, asked the hardest question maybe in the history of the show that was pertinent to what we were talking about. It was ridiculous.
Yeah, I just finished listening to it. I was like, that's not even fair.
No, it wasn't. Like, the thing about Will's questions was he would ask, like, questions about rock lava and shit. You know, it was supposed to be funny, but Sean, he's a fucking maniac. All right, David Dooley, what did you say?
Hey, do we need to let him go first?
Okay, Chris. Oh, yeah, you're right. Thank you, Jared Spear.
It's cool. I wasn't going to cheat. I cannot remember the damn song because the scene is so funny. I'm not even paying attention to what song is playing.
All right. Now, I noticed Chris Cranfill nodding. Chris, what did you say?
I touched myself.
All right.
Oh,
Dooley.
Damn it. Dooley. I said Secret Agent Man. I cracked up when I saw it earlier.
Chris Cranfill is correct, ladies and gentlemen.
Divine.
All right. Question number four. David Dooley with two, Chris Cranfill with two, and Jared with one. Question number four will, of course, be about the movie Austin Powers. In the movie Austin Powers, what does he get back? Name. Now, hold on. That's a fucking stupid question. Sean, edit this out or leave it in. I don't fucking care. Question number four will, of course, be about the movie Austin Powers. In the movie Austin Powers, in the blackjack game, what do his two cards add up to? In the blackjack game that he plays against number two, what do his cards add up to? Did you guys notice that that was the soup Nazi?
Yeah.
I was just going to say that. Yeah.
Yeah.
No soup for you.
One month.
He's on Cameo.
And not doing the act. He wasn't doing the accent.
No, either. Well, it's, you know, because he's just a regular dude, but he's on Cameo and he'll just do the thing for you. No soup for you. Or whatever. It's like $75.
He's been in a bunch of shit too, man.
He has, yeah. All right, Jared, what did you say?
Five.
Chris Cranfill.
I had five.
Boss man David Dooley.
Five.
That is, of course, correct. Five is correct.
I recommend music, sir.
Question number five, by the way. David Dooley, going into this one, David Dooley with three, Chris Cranfill with three, and Jared with two. But remember, it's anybody's game until the very end, because that's the way we designed it. Question number five will, of course, be about the movie Austin Powers. In the movie Austin Powers, what is the name of Will Ferrell's character?
Oh, shit.
What is the name of Will Ferrell's character? You shot me in the arm.
That's why I'm laughing. You
Why'd
shot
you do
me
that?
In the arm.
Damn it.
In the arm.
Why did you do that? I'm in a lot of pain. All right, Jared Spear, what you got?
I don't know. I know it starts with an M, I believe, but I can't remember what it
All
is.
All right, and he gives you a hint on that. David Dooley.
Mustafa.
Okay, and Chris Cranfill.
Mustafa.
Mustafa is correct. Ooh, they like that. They like it because they see Sean walking up. Ladies and gentlemen, let me get back to my notes because it is now time for Eric is on a tangent again, question number six.
In the film Austin Powers, the intro dance scene is soundtracked by the Quincy Jones song Soul Bossa Nova. Quincy Jones sits in second place all time for the most Grammy Awards won with 28. What country bluegrass Americana artist is just behind him in career Grammy wins with 27?
Ooh. Ooh. I think I know, actually. He gives you a hint.
Guess.
He gives you a hint in there. Would you guys like to hear the question one more time?
Yeah, I think it's, yeah.
In the film Austin Powers, the intro dance scene is soundtracked by the Quincy Jones song Soul Bossa Nova. Quincy Jones sits in second place all time for the most Grammy Awards won with 28. What country bluegrass Americana artist is just behind him in career Grammy wins with 27?
Okay.
That's a tough one.
Yeah, that is really tough, actually. I might not know it. I might just be being a dick. You know,
I'm going to have to guess anyway.
All right, Jared, I'm going to let Chris Cranfill finish writing, and then we will, of course, go to you. Looks David Dooley just looks lost. You all look defeated. Jared Spear.
Yeah, I know six country artists to begin with.
All right, name one.
I'm going to go with Willie Nelson.
All right. And then Chris Cranfill.
I put Jared Reddick just to be a butt.
Hey, yeah. Fuck yeah. Now I got beaten at the Grammys. and earlier by myself, I'll tell you that much. David Dooley, what you got?
I said Dolly Parton.
That is a really good guess. I was going to say Vince.
I would actually believe that. I would believe that.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah.
Jared, play the bottom one.
Oh, I can't believe it.
Jesus fucking Christ. Your answer.
Wait, hold on. That's the. Oh, no. The
Jesus
bottom
fucking
one?
Christ. Your answer was more worthless than Anne Frank's drum set. The correct answer is Alison Krauss, noted frontwoman for her band Union Station.
Alison Krauss. Huh. Now, remember, she won a bunch with the Led Zeppelin guy. And she's
Robert Plant. Yeah,
she's done a bunch of stuff. Wow, that is crazy. Good.
Yeah, never would have gotten that.
I would have never gotten that. That's a fucking hard question.
Me either.
Yeah. I was just trying to think of who had been around the longest.
Well, we find ourselves in an amazing situation. It is question number seven time. It is time for Jared Spear to try to win it all. Here's how it works, guys. Jared Spear will now get to try to answer the next question coming up. If he gets it right, he wins. If he doesn't get it right, then we will have a tiebreaker. But let's wait and see what happens here first. As we get into Sean's super hard question presented by freaking sharks and lasers pool hall. We got balls and holes. Bring your stick and fill them.
All right, Jared, we got three questions here. I don't have any categories, so just choose one, two, or three.
Two.
Mike Myers has stated in several interviews where his inspiration for the impression of Dr. Evil was developed. Which person from SNL is it based from?
Lorne Michaels.
That is correct.
Oh! Did you get it right?
I know my SNL shit, man.
Wow, guys. Wow.
I wouldn't have gotten that.
It just goes to show you that no matter where you are in the game, you can always win. And ladies and gentlemen, you know, you guys scored well, David and Chris, and you're not losers, but you didn't win, did you? Our winner today, Jared Spear, goes up to two wins, guys. Give him up one more time. Let's hear it. One of our presidents, and of course, Cranfill, former sponsor of the show. And you guys are awesome. Thank you guys so very much for taking time out of your day to be here. Thank you more so for being amazing sponsors of this show. We could not do it without you, and I do mean that from the bottom of my heart. You guys enjoy the rest of your night. Come hang with us on Facebook if you can. We'll be on in about 17 minutes. And y'all stay safe. Stay healthy, okay, guys?
Thank you.
You too, man.
Bye, guys.
See you later.
Here's Basil.
Hello, exposition.
Austin, let me bring you up to speed. Dr. Evil has hijacked a nuclear warhead from Kreplakistan.
Only two things scare me, and one is nuclear war.
What's the other?
Excuse me?
What's the other thing that scares you?
Carnies.
What?
Circus folk. Nomads, you know. Smell like cabbage. Small hands.
Indeed.
Perhaps these photographs are the last piece of the puzzle.
Aha. Uh-huh.
I've uncovered the details of Project Vulcan.
Oh, good God. An underground missile?
Austin, where did you find these?
Austin did some reconnaissance work last night at A Lot of Vaginas penthouse. Our next move is to infiltrate Virtucon. Any ideas?
Oh, yes. Virtucon runs a tour of its facility every hour. I thought perhaps we could disguise ourselves as tourists and do some on-site reconnaissance.
Top draw, Kensington.
Top draw!
Maybe that should make a comeback.
Maybe. That's a... we did a show one time in front of about five people. And they were all in the band that played before us. And they sat in the audience, and after every every song, they'd go, top draw. And they would say, like, very, very lovely. And act like we were, like, very performing lovely. In front of, like, a bunch of old English dudes. And it was fucking great. So the next
what
night we played.
What English dude is that dude?
What? Hello.
Yeah.
Chow. They're like the fucking old, like.
Is that real or is that just, like, offensive?
That's a real thing.
There's a guy like that? Like still running around.
And Casey, he has the hat.
Casey, they still wear wigs in court there.
I know, but I
no way.
100%. That's absolutely. If you're on trial for a crime, your lawyer, the judge, and everybody else in there of any sort
Amy's
of
face right
thing,
now is my favorite.
Wait, does Rodon James wear a fucking wig to court?
No, because
wait,
he's,
it's like the long white, like what I'm thinking in my head.
That's correct. So I'll tell you why I know that. Rodon, one of them is called a solicitor, and one of them is called something else.
A barrister.
That's it. So one of them,
trivia guy,
one of them wears that shit and one of them doesn't. So whichever one it isn't, Rodon James is that guy.
Yeah. I'd be that guy too.
Oh my.
Yeah.
Goodness.
But they still like dress up. Like, so let's say you're on trial for murder. Everybody's dressed up in a fucking costume telling you like what your fucking fate is over there.
That's right. Because that was on the documentary about the guy that was supposedly the,
Eric's opening a beer.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Person?
Yep.
Right.
Ivan the Terrible.
Ivan the Terrible,
because
yeah.
They had to wear them, too.
That's right.
Yep.
Oh, my gosh.
I know.
They still do it, because that was a while
still
ago.
Still do it. It's fucking crazy.
Maybe we should wear them for this podcast.
We should 100% have them. Anytime we get in a dispute, we should have to.
Jared's
I totally agree.
You just have
I do. I think there should be like one of those like. But the intro to like divorce court, like the dun dun dun, you know,
that's a good one.
Guys, mark this down. Casey likes one of my bits. So we're going to try to make, we're going to replace that's something that Jarrett says and the heavy metal song with we're all going to be solicitors.
It's fine with the heavy metal song. I just didn't like it at the live Lava Cantina ones with fucking confused ass Anthony Michael Hall wondering why we're playing screaming death metal at him for.
That's not.
Okay, I get it now.
That's not what you said.
That's a Christmas song.
Way to go. Good one.
Let's talk about group therapy with Princess Leia.
Can't even eat jambalaya. I'm allergic.
And just that whole scene is so great. Just of the fathers and sons or whatever. And just how it fucking, where it comes into, and that was something that we would say too back in the day. We were like, I want to be a vet. An evil vet? You know, I want to, okay, maybe I'll own a petting zoo. An evil petting zoo? You know, like.
I didn't know that your Dr. Evil was so good.
Oh, thank you very much. I didn't either, actually. That was, I just that discovered that. Thank you. An evil.
Maybe a two-way petting zoo. Where you pet the animals and then they pet you back.
What do you think about
That's illegal.
What do you think about a heavy petting zoo?
I'm into it.
I think that's
where
like,
all
that's, like,
the goats are wearing
like,
sweaters
or wigs,
and you're allowed to go.
And they're barristers, and all of the goats are playing, and you're fucking the system. God damn it, we're onto something, guys.
Oh,
this
no.
is gonna be huge.
Kids' parties will never be the same.
Nope.
That's true. And then. So when he starts to talk about his childhood, he's like, yeah, so my dad, you know, he would claim things like he invented the question mark. And then he goes, and then he just, this entire description about his dad was so fucking, do they ever do a thing where they show Dr. Evil as a kid?
Yeah, and that's what the whole second or third movie is about.
Okay. All right, well, then that makes a lot of sense, because that is fucking would be so funny to see
his mother with webbed feet.
I just assume that it's going to be, though, like what's that really good movie that Steve Carell, the cartoon one or whatever with the minions?
Despicable Me.
Despicable Me. So he has a movie coming out where he's a kid and he's just basically exactly the same.
Right.
It seems like that's what. Do you guys watch Despicable Me over there, Eric?
I've seen the first one, I believe.
Man, you know what's funny is them goddamn minions. I just think they are the funniest thing. So he admits that he shags a lot of vagina. He shags are rotten. And so she starts to get pissed and he goes, "Ooh, saucer of milk for table two."
No, but isn't this where he goes? Because she says, "Are you going
to? Did you use a condom?
Did you use a condom? He goes, "That's just for sailors who go port to port." And she goes, "Not anymore." And he goes, "Oh, well, they should."
Did you use protection? Well, I had a huge.
By 9 millimeter.
9 millimeter. Oh, so good. And then that's kind of a sad thing, though, where he goes out and he's just sitting on the couch. When he's like, "I knew Jimi Hendrix, and oh, he's dead, and then this guy's dead, and this guy," you know, he's kind of starting to figure it all out, right?
Yeah, but like drugs, alcohol, ham sandwich.
Am I the only one that just says ham sandwich if anyone wants a ham sandwich?
Right. And then.
Yes, you're the only one that does that.
Thanks, Eric.
And you asked the question.
And then, She, you know, she wakes up. She's just like, you know, okay, yeah, there's, you know, we walked on the moon. There's the wall. And he just goes, "I just can't believe Liberace is gay. Who's women loved him. Who saw that coming?"
Didn't see that coming. Yeah.
Judo chop.
Hey, by the way, did you know that the guy who plays Random Task is in prison for murder?
Who's Random Task?
Oh.
The Korean guy that throws his shoe.
What? He threw a shoe at somebody?
In the movie. Right. He threw a shoe at him whenever he brought in,
oh
like,
my God.
Their wedding stuff.
Yeah.
And that's why he's in prison, right?
Yeah. Because he killed somebody at somebody at the thing or whatever. Someone. Like,
his kappa was detached from his body.
Was he on the set of The Crow? God. Like, what happened?
I was just watching that again like the other day. I always go back and just revisit how fucked up that is.
Oh, really?
That is a fucking super deep joke.
Is it?
Yeah. Anyway, go ahead, Eric. Tell us what you know.
The guy that played Odd Job, or not Odd Job, Random Task in this film is in prison for murder.
When did he go to prison?
In the year 2000.
In the year 2000.
I don't know if that's when it was, but I just knew that if I said that, you guys would pop in. No, I was looking for this when I was looking for my trivia question. Okay, here we go.
Oh, yay.
Y'all shut the fuck up. Sorry. Joe's son.
Sorry.
The actor who played Random Task is serving a lifetime in prison for torture of a 19-year-old woman in 1990. So the event in question happened in 1990. This movie came out in 1997. So when this movie was filmed, he had already done the thing that ended up with him in prison.
Shit fire.
He went uncaptured until 2008 when a DNA match linked him to the crime. According to the victim, she unknowingly had a copy of this movie in her home until her attacker's identity was revealed.
Oh, my God.
In 2017, he was sentenced to an additional 27 years for murdering his cellmate.
Oh, shit. With a shoe.
I was going to say that, but I can't talk because he's going to start talking over me. God damn it.
But really with a shoe?
Yeah.
Anyway, so all that happened.
That's really interesting.
That is fucking amazing. Guys, this just in. Nobody died. Everybody's fine.
Except for that guy's cellmate.
Well, somebody died.
New $50 supporter Joey Bishop is back, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Joey. We're happy you're here. Here comes a clip for you. This is dedicated to Joey Bishop.
Welcome to my underground lair. You're just in time. Enjoy the show. Gentlemen, I give you the Vulcan. The world's most powerful subterranean drill.
Does that make you horny?
Not now, Austin.
so powerful it can penetrate the Earth's crust, delivering a 50 kiloton nuclear warhead deep into the liquid hot core of the planet. Upon detonation, every volcano on Earth will erupt.
It seems we have no choice but to pay your ransom.
You have my instructions. Bye-bye.
Check it out, butthead. This chick has three boobs.
How many butts does she have?
Today is gonna be the... Sorry, I was gonna sing along. So a lot happens here. They have to take him into the conference room and feed him, right? And then Scott comes in, of course, and is being his own self, Scott, and his story about what they did that day. And Paris talk, by the way, that is something that Jared says. She doesn't like the sound clip, so I'm going to just do it myself now.
I know, but then when you say it like that, it makes me feel like you're making fun of me.
How about this? Hey, that's something I say all the time.
There you go.
And that's the whole thing.
That is something Jared says. That is something Jared says.
So I tried to make note of this exchange, but this is one of the best exchanges of all time, of just Scott and Dr. Evil, where he's like, he comes in and he's like, hey, they're just doing Paris talk. You know, hey, do you want to watch a movie with me on Skinemax later? He's like, I got work to do. You know, well, I'll help you. And he's like, you know, right now I'm going to put everybody in easily escapable situation where they die an exotic death, you know, and
I have a gun in my room.
My room right now. Just
I will bring it down.
And then he's just like, what's going to happen is there's going to be sharks with laser beams. And then number two is because
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry, Jarrett.
It
was going to be very expensive.
Here? What do we have? Like, and it's just like, we've got sea bass. Are they mutated?
They're very hungry.
Are they ill-tempered? Like, just like...
ill-tempered. And then he goes, absolutely.
Yeah. Absolutely. Just such a... You know, and then the... What are some of the ones that they do? Like the
zippity doo. That's the next one.
That's the next one.
That's right.
Let me tell you a story about a man named Shh.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
Today was going to be the day that we
throw it all in the back. Stupid. I like that, man. That's a good one.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so they're in there. They're in there in the, they are in a pickle, right? And
guys, what are they going to do?
She gets the floss out and he goes, okay, I get it. I have bad teeth. And just anytime he says judo chop, my wife starts laughing.
Cause we used to do that shit all the time. It's like a middle school. Someone just walk up and be like, judo chop to the back of your neck.
Judo chop, judo trip.
Judo trip.
So, and then, so they basically put the dude's head into the sea bass and he's like, not the best time to lose one's head. She's like, no, not a good way to get ahead in life. No. Not that headstrong, is he? No.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's enough.
It's never going to be head of a major corporation. Okay, that's enough. Let's go. I fucking love that shit. That is fucking comedy. That makes me fucking laugh a lot. Let's check in with Sean. Sean, how you doing over there, buddy?
Oh, I'm good.
I'm good.
Okay.
Poor Sean.
Yeah, he can't be on camera.
Did you guys see when he's on the roller thing? I don't know if I'm skipping ahead, but he's on the little steam roller thing, and the guy's real far away, and he's like, stop!
Yeah.
That's Stuart. That is the guy that plays Stuart on Mad
TV.
Oh,
really?
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Oh!
That's funny.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. Yeah, you are ahead.
Sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, it's the gift that keeps on giving the whole year long, Clark.
So good.
Oh man. All right, here we go. What are we doing right now? Oh, okay. So we went through the I have a gun, head of a major corporation. Okay, so again, him trying to turn that cart around in that stupid hallway is, I mean, like,
I still say it.
How they, what?
I'm going to Austin Powers if you have to, like, make a
thing. Exactly, right?
Yeah.
That has to be a thing.
Yeah.
Ding, ding. I want chicken. I want liver. Meow mix, please deliver.
I've got you now, Dr. Evil.
Well done, Mr. Powers. We're not so different, you and I. However, isn't it ironic that the very things that you stand for, free love, swinging, parties,
Jared's opening a bill,
considered to be evil?
And that we swingers were rebelling against his uptight squares like you, whose bag was money and world domination. We were innocent, man. If we'd known the consequences of our sexual liberation, we would have done things differently, but the spirit would have remained the same. It's freedom, baby, yeah.
Face it, freedom failed.
No, man, freedom didn't fail. Right now we've got freedom and responsibility. It's a very groovy time.
There's nothing more pathetic than an aging hipster.
That's you, Eric. Oh. Oh, he's not there to take it.
Take it.
That's fine. That is fine.
And he really took that break seriously.
I'm looking at baby bald cats, and I think you need to reconsider.
That what? No, I'm not doing that.
Look at him.
Freedom isn't like? Free. It's a hefty fucking free.
That looks like what the little gremlins.
Yeah, they're the best.
No, I don't want any part of that.
I'm gonna just get one.
No, that won't happen. Actually,
that reminds me of the episode down? Of Friends when Rachel buys one and they have to handle it with the oven mitts.
you know what the best part of this is, Eric. Eric, it is. We only have two clips left, and you know the last one doesn't take very long. You went ahead and grabbed two beers. Atta, baby.
Oh,
yeah, did you baby.
Did you like my cat pajamas?
Yeah, we saw those earlier.
Oh shit, I didn't see them.
Wait. How long are those? Are they shorts or are they pants?
Capris?
They're pants.
They're capris. Yeah.
Yeah, they're your cat pajama capri pants.
Cat capris.
Yeah. Everybody has those. They had a special on
like a
Jane
Gaucho pant.
Is it Gaucho,
like the those? Saggy crotch kind that Justin Bieber used to wear.
Justin Bieber.
Yeah.
Chat room says I can have one. By the way,
what?
Chat room. Right, says let's start a GoFundMe for Casey to get a hairless.
Chat room can suck it.
I'm gonna get one. It's gonna love you more than me, and it's gonna stress you out.
That's what I'm saying. Here's the thing. I feel like we get one of those things. I'm going to have to carry it around all the time.
It's you would love it.
Want me all the time. Aren't they like $2,000?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're expensive. We're just going to start a...
We spent $2,000 on stupider shit than that. For
sure. Yeah. I would say a miniature moat for the model of your house to show where the new moat was going to be.
Yeah.
No. No. Hold on. No, we have a factory that makes miniature moats.
Yes.
In Chicago.
Yeah.
That was a good loop into the movie.
Chicago miniature you. Moat factory.
Thank you. Now Scott is now he just fucking Scott. He is like, I hate you. I hate you. Right. And then number two comes in. He's got a fembot in the fucking suitcase.
Okay, I will tell you that this was one of the things I did not notice.
I never noticed that before either. And I
lost
a million
my
times.
Shit. I uh-huh. fucking saw that. I was just like, oh my God, he's got a fembot in the fucking suitcase, right?
Well, see you later.
Yeah. It's, so that was the first time you noticed that too, Eric?
Yes. I laughed and paused it and go... Because Kelsey, whenever we watch these things, is just on her phone, like buying shit. And
that's
miniature
weird.
Moats.
No, we only have one moat, so we already have the moat on the miniature thing. We don't need.
Well, because y'all built your house. That's why. Because you got to put it in the beginning. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, we had a whole are slumming it over here with one moat.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But anyhow, yeah, I paused it and went, look, he's got a fembot in the suitcase. I never.
Yeah, I didn't see one new thing in this movie. Like, there was not one part that I didn't remember or know what they were going to say next. And I'd never seen that.
Yeah, that was the thing that. Like,
yeah.
Because I called attention to it. I was like, he's got a fembot.
Yeah, I remember that part, though.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, man. So I had only seen this. I mean, I've seen this movie probably twice.
Really? I used to watch it over and over and over again.
Well, you got to remember, so 97, we were just on the road. So we didn't go see new movies. And so like whatever we had on VHS is what we watched in the thing. I've seen The Nutty Professor 12,000 times.
Right.
Pulp Fiction, 16,000 times. And Eric's Vagina. How many times, Eric, have I seen that?
I don't know, just twice, but only once was on purpose.
And then Big Boy is going to self-destruct. And they just the fact that they chose Big Boy is here. Has anybody ever actually been to a Big Boy?
No. I didn't even think that it was
Casey,
real.
Casey, you probably went to a Big Boy in San Diego, right?
Oh, no, we were broke. We just ate ramen noodles and really
so
cheap
nobody's
vodka.
Been to a Big Boy?
No.
Eric, you ever been to? Oh, Sean, you been to a Big Boy? Where at?
Burbank.
Yeah, California.
Uh-huh.
Eric, no?
No, I don't even know where you would find one. Is it a West Coast thing? Or
there's a bunch in the West Coast, yeah. It's like a Sambo's or like, fuck do you call it? Like a diner thing. You go in there, they've got everything or whatever.
Are they still around?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Providing quality service?
At affordable prices.
They sure are. Yeah. And then, so this is towards the end of the movie. And he's like, it's going to blow. And we need one last gag. So he has to rack himself on the gear shift. And I fucking thought it was hilarious. Perfectly timed.
It's always funny.
Just anytime somebody gets hit in the balls, always funny. How about you, Eric? You think things are funny when you get hit in the balls? Wait a minute. Holy shit. Let me tell you.
Isn't there a Family Guy?
Let me tell you about getting hit in the balls.
Oh shit.
So I haven't been like racked in it's been a very long time. I'm in a rock
when
band.
When you say racked, you mean like a girl's hands on both of your shoulders and just knee right up into the crotch? Or do you just mean racked, like got hit in the balls?
Okay, getting hit in the balls like by a football or something like that. Like, where it takes a minute and then all of a sudden, like the opposite side of your body hurts and shit, like all that stuff. I've had that a few times here and there. But like full, like what you described, it's been a very long time. Now, I have been a rock and roll band and the movie Jackass came out. And so I've been hitting the balls with some shit, but I just always feel like I was kind of expecting it and, whatever. So the other day, this is weird. I don't know if any of you guys have been doing this since coronavirus. We were watching television and anybody else doing that these days at all?
So much.
Anyway, so
I started this thing, Ozark. Have y'all heard of this?
Yeah. Oh, where are you on that?
Season 1, episode 3.
I need to start watching that.
Are y'all, wait a minute, have you not watched at all?
No.
You've never seen Ozark?
We watched the first one, maybe two episodes.
You said, and you couldn't keep going.
No, well, I think we tried that and something else at the same time.
You liked
and
it
we
then.
Went with whatever.
It's totally fucking worth it. But that show is weird because it does slow down from time to time, and it takes a minute to pick back up, but once it does, holy fuck.
Well, I'm getting a Breaking Bad vibe from it, just development wise anyway, but that's not about getting hit in the balls.
So the dogs, I have huge dogs. I have one.
Who?
I have one that is almost 9 pounds. She's enormous. I have one that is 100 pounds and one that's 125. Now the 125, super gentle. She's fucking great. She's a massive. She's lazy as fuck. She's a runt. Actually, her father was 100 pounds more than her. But she's chill. She doesn't really do a lot of things that would do any damage. The 100-pound dog is a boxer mastiff, and he behaves like a boxer. So he's bigger than a normal boxer, and everything that he does is essentially like he's on cocaine. And so...
Should I stop giving him cocaine?
He just happened to be in the one spot on the couch, and Hazel needed to go outside. And just the words outside happened, and he full on went up on his hind legs and just planted right on my balls to launch himself over me to get outside. And it was the first time I had been like,
it was bad,
full on to where like I felt like I couldn't breathe. Like, things were numb on my body.
Did you think you were going to throw up? That's what
I thought. I was going to throw up
several times.
I did. I was like, I think I'm going to throw up.
Derek
said, I'm probably going to throw up. I'm like leaning over the, I'm leaning over the bar or whatever. She's like, what can I do? I'm like, don't move. Just fucking everybody stay still. You know, like I was a mess, and I had not felt that in so long. So please, for the love of God, everybody, don't hit anybody in the balls.
That sounds awful.
The more you know. It was fucking terrible. It really was. And then, and you know what fucked up is he doesn't even know he did anything bad, so you can't get mad at him. You know? Like, if he fucks something up, which he hasn't done in so long, he doesn't really ever do anything wrong. He was a terrible puppy, but he's the best.
Worst puppy ever.
Yeah, I mean, just literally used to shit on the top of the couch.
Would mountain goat himself up on the and then just shit on the top of it.
Yeah.
They call that an upper decker.
Yeah.
He was the fucking worst.
God, it was so bad. Yeah, you'd have to take all the couch cushions off and like wash them. Oh. And then in the time that you were doing that, he would take like the stuffing and just fucking destroy it. And it was like for like a year. I mean, it was a long stretch.
God, I'm surprised you didn't turn that dog into glue.
Woody Chambers has a Mastiff mix that's 145. Yeah, so his mom was 180, or her mom was 185. Her dad was 225. So she
sounds like my mom and dad.
Yeah, she's the... Let me think about that for a second. Yeah, that's about right.
Maybe.
Wait, I've met your dad. Yeah, he's tall, you know?
Yeah, he's 6'3", so...
Yeah, he is. Oh, he's fucking 6'3".
Look how beautiful the night sky is.
Hey, isn't that the Big Dipper?
Yeah, and that looks just like Uranus.
Austin.
Well, you know.
Hey, I've never seen that big star before.
Yeah, what is that? Good God.
I'm gonna get you, Austin Powers. It's frickin' freezing in here, Mr. Bigglesworth.
Aww. The reason we can't get one of those cats is because that's what they look like when they're cold.
We'll give them a sweater.
Mrs. Will ya make me tea? Make love to me.
Well, all in all, I think that's a good movie. I really thought that it was really, really funny. I did not expect it to be as funny as it was this many years later. So I thought it was an enjoyable watch. Eric, you're going to stick with your 70%?
Yeah. It's not like I didn't laugh or find things about it funny. I think it was just remembering back to how many people for how many years did the Austin Powers thing, and it was just fucking annoying, and so maybe it just made the movie more annoying for me.
You feel like that's what's going to happen with Borat, though? Like,
yes.
Like, yeah?
Borat? I wonder. I haven't seen Borat in many years, and so I wonder if I watched it tonight, what I just find it annoying because it was so overdone by so many people for so long.
That's how I feel about Napoleon Dynamite.
Yeah, I feel like Napoleon Dynamite might be more equal to Austin Powers than Borat.
Yeah, So here's the thing about
that
Napoleon.
Was during your not watching movies time.
That's
your life.
Correct.
Yeah,
and I've seen Napoleon Dynamite. I definitely don't get the insanity behind it. I thought it was fine. It was funny.
Yeah.
This movie is fucking amazing, but Borat is on another goddamn level. Like,
I don't know. You're like a ninth grader and your mom goes to college all day.
Oh, yeah.
All right. You guys are saying this and Napoleon Dynamite, y'all are putting it a level up over Borat.
Yeah, I think so.
All right. So you felt
as a matter of like quotability, popularity.
Interesting.
I think Borat was popular, but it didn't have like that instant cult following that Napoleon Dynamite did.
And
I don't think.
You felt like, so your take on it, Amy, was you this one's high up. You thought it was.
Oh, this one's number one.
Like Austin I'm talking Powers, like, yeah, sure. like.
Out of those three, you're saying?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Easy.
And Casey, you felt like this aged pretty good. I mean, that you watched it a lot as a 9-year-old and now you're almost 19.
Yeah. Exactly. So I can't.
Sorry. I'm sorry. I did that. Okay.
I don't even know what I was going to say anymore.
Sorry.
Where does Anchorman fit into the quotability scale?
There's a whole other section of like Will Ferrell shit.
Here's the thing about Anchorman and Step Brothers to me. Are literally in another solar system.
I agree.
I just don't even know what kind of movie. Maybe Dumb and Dumber.
That's a good one, but I don't even think there's that many when you get to the Step Brothers.
Yeah, and Anchorman, where literally every line in Anchorman. Yeah. Anchorman is like one of those things where it's like a symphony. It's like they went in there and they were just like, okay, here's the thing. We're going to make every single line from every single character count.
Yep.
And
they did it.
Very nice.
And they fuck it. Okay, see, now that's not Anchorman, Eric. That was Borat. I'm not sure if you remember that or not, but.
Yeah.
So the fruit basket scene I thought was amazing. And not just because I got to see that bone on the side of Elizabeth Hurley that runs right between the ribs and the hip. Like, it's not the reason I enjoyed it that much.
But you did.
But I did.
You want to see some more?
No, not
don't,
of you.
Don't pull
no,
down
no, no.
the cat.
I have the internet. Jesus Christ. And then, but I did like the fruit basket. And they're just like, and did you get the other thing? I said, yes. Oh, this is a nice rack, baby. You know, it's a spice rack, you know, which, you know. Okay. And then the milk. And then apparently a murderer breaks into their room and throws a shoe. And he fights like a girl. So
it's a good thing they got out alive.
That was a good trivia piece.
100%. So guys, here's the thing. The show's not over yet. We still got a little bit to go, but connect with us. Our website's JarrettGoesToTheMovies.com. You can find us Jarrett Goes to the Movies on Facebook, and we got a fan page on Facebook. Jarrett Movies on Instagram, Patreon. You can find us at Jarrett Goes to the Movies, and we do appreciate your support. JarrettGoesToTheMovies@gmail.com. You can send us an email or text us or leave us a voicemail. 714-451-6029.
Let's check the email box. Email us at jarrettgoestothemovies@gmail.com.
Dear Eric, not the crew, just to me. This is just to me. You guys don't even have to listen. After a quick blurb about wanting me to tell my story about pooping out of a helicopter on last week's live episode, I mulled it over, and rather than me tell it, I thought it would sound so much more soothing coming from your melodic voice. It's not too long, but you may need to take a drink before you start.
Are you out? I got Miller Lights in there.
In 2003, during the initial invasion of Iraq, we were in Mosul and doing troop inserts into the town. We had been eating nothing but MREs, meals ready to eat, which under prolonged use clog you up like eating three whole blocks of cheddar cheese. You anxiously wait for that first MRE dump, usually 3 days, because you know that A, your tummy tum will stop hurting, and B, your asshole will start hurting. Now, after eating MREs for the past 3 days, everyone is craving real food. That afternoon, they opened up the base and many locals came on. giving us naan, it's flatbread, and trading us Iraqi money for American money, etc. I must have eaten four large pieces of naan. It was fucking delicious. Later that night, we inserted a group of Marines into downtown Mosul. After the insert, we moved out to the outskirts of town in a holding pattern. I was a crew member on a CH-46 helicopter at the time, which looks like a flying penis. No, for real. Look up a picture. But inside the helicopter, in the very middle, is a large hatch.
I want you to go all the way to the bottom of my penis.
Thank you for your service, Woody. But inside the helicopter in the very middle is a large hatch with a 3-foot by 3-foot wide hole, just like you, Jarrett, that opens up that we call the hell hole. As we were in a holding pattern, the bubble guts started. The tummy gurgled. I started sweating. My mouth became dry and swamp ass began. I had to shit violently. Normally, we use an empty ammo can, but all the cans we had were full of 50 caliber ammunition. So that option is out. I asked the pilot how much longer we have on station until we pick them up. 30 minutes. My sphincter could not last 30 minutes. Come on.
Roadhouse.
Can't wait to hear that one next week. It had to go, and it had to go now. So I opened up the hellhole, removed flight gear and flight suit, hung on to a seat, and squatted so that my ass was as far down into the hellhole as possible. Then I unleashed hell. I mean, 3 days of MRE backed up did nothing to stop the grease explosion facilitated by Stranger Non. It is at this point in the story that I would like to sincerely apologize to anyone who lived on the outskirts of the town of Mosul. After completion of Operation Foamy Butthole, I tore off a piece of my undershirt, closed the hatch to my flight suit and helicopter, and resumed my freedom duties. Moral of the story is, never accept Nan from a stranger.
Oh, man.
Oh, and Eric, I'll cuddle with you, buddy, but I'm the big spoon. Take care, y'all. Woody.
Oh man, goodness. Woody, holy crap, you're the goddamn
best. P.S. Put that pause in there just for Jarrett.
Sucking multiple cocks.
Is that it, or are we?
P.P.S. Got him.
I knew it. Got him. Yep, you got me.
P.S.S.S.
Motherfucking shit.
That's a good story.
Yeah, that was good, man. And you know, anyone listening, thank you so very much for your service. But
I am the only one on the show who has the courage to say thank you, guys, troops, for your service. I really do appreciate it. So thank you.
You stole that from us.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Thank you for sharing the show. We appreciate it. Hey, when we put out a thing, if you share it, you get to hear your name. Thank you, Clarissa. Let me take that again. Thank you, Clarissa James, Chris Cranfill, Joey Bishop, Carrie Lynn Abner, Harry Jenkins, Joe Bennett, Woody Chambers. You just heard about him taking a shit out of a fucking helicopter. April Caps, Loreen Ingram, Jerry Atrix.
It's not even that funny.
It's not even dirty. It's so just fucking funny because it's not dirty. It's so stupid.
But it is a group that we should thank every once in a while.
thank you. They're kind of in a little bit of a pickle right now.
I was going to say, thank you, Geriatrics, and sorry about coronavirus.
Oh, no.
Hope to see you next week on the show. Paul Gonzalez, Todd Parker, Cheyenne Brown, Samuel L. Chang.
From Threat Level Midnight?
Got it. Barry Ferguson, Pete Meister, Lusky Ray Dotson, Ryan Howard, Shanna Durkee.
Woohoo!
There she is, coming in. Jasmine Winsong, Taylor Moose, Wade Dilla, Steve McCracken, Johnny Mahoney, Kelly Aaron Hannon, Greg Daniels, Hunter Cagle, Michael Schur, Chris Pulse, Colton Schwartz, Simon Rogers, Roy Anderson, Vivian LaFuntasy. Vivian LaFuntasy?
LaFuntasy.
Is that a dirty one, or am I just fucking up her name?
You're just fucking up her name.
Vivian LaFuntasy. LaFuntasy. Vivian LaFuntasy. Tess Green, Gage Strickland, Stuart May, Bob Kosmakis, and Michael Skarn. Thank you guys for sharing. Hey guys, what a fun episode. Sean, thank you so much. Eric, you're the goddamn best, baby. Thank you so much for being the goddamn bestest ever. And Amy, we're so happy you're here.
Thanks, guys.
And guys, stick with us through this whole thing.
Especially you, geriatrics.
We're going to be here. Hey, any of you geriatrics that make it to next week, we'll see you down the road.
Way to go.